Be quiet. If you do all the talking all the while, how is God going to talk to us? Right? When I'm talking, you all are silently listening. If I'm talking and you are talking at the same time, we cannot understand each other. Am I right? Someone needs to be quiet. So many, many years ago, there was a dear friend of mine who has an accounting firm in Singapore. He asked me to pray for him. He said, please pray that God will speak to me. And he told me, you know, when I go to churches, he was a very, very traditional Christian for many, many years. And then he got saved, got baptized in the Holy Spirit. And he was starting his life in the Spirit. But he never felt anything in the church. He's always like a log of wood. Are you there? You mean you are a wood? So, and you know, the young people in his church, they used to give testimony, oh, I felt the Lord's presence, I felt this, I felt that. Everybody gives all kinds of testimonies. I felt the goosebumps, I felt the red bumps. And he tells me, you know, I don't even feel anything, not even a mosquito bite. So he said, please pray for me. You always see the Lord. The next time when you see the Lord, please pray for me. I said, all right, brother, I'll pray for you. So, after many days later, during my period of intercession, as I was waiting on the Lord, I saw the Lord Jesus. And I was praying for the many needs for which people write to me. So, when I was through, I suddenly remembered this brother's request. So I told the Lord, Lord, I have one more request to ask you. So I brought my friend's problem to the Lord. I said, Lord, why you are so unfair? The Lord looked at me as if he has never ever heard such a thing in his life before. Which is true, no? He's not unfair, right? He's impartial. So why you are so unfair? So the Lord looked at me with that look on his face. And then I brought up my friend's problem. So I said, Lord, when you can do all these things to all other people, they feel this, they feel that, they feel goosebumps, they feel that problem, at least, Lord, send your angel to pinch him. At least a little pinch will do some good for him. If he can't hear your voice, he can't feel this, he can't see that, at least pinch him. Let him say, ouch! That will be good enough. And the Lord listened with great patience to what I was saying. And then the Lord said, the problem is not with me, the problem is with him. I said, what do you mean, Lord, the problem is with him? He has a great desire to see you. He has a great desire to hear your voice. How can you say the problem is with him? The Lord looked at me and said, come, I'll show you. When he said that, he tapped me on my forehead. As soon as he tapped, I saw a vision of what happens in his house in a typical morning. So I saw this scene. He was getting ready to go to work. He gathered his three children. They all got dressed and they fed them. He and his wife fed them quick breakfast and they all knelt down to pray. So when they all prayed, each one by one, they prayed. Then this brother prayed. He said, Lord, bless my three children, bless my wife, bless my mother, bless my father, bless my pastor. And he named a few ministers of God that he knew. He said, bless everybody, Lord. All this while, as he was praying, I saw the Lord Jesus standing by his side. You know, that day, I saw and realized one thing. Whenever we pray, God comes to hear our prayer. Amen. Whether we see or we don't see, that doesn't matter. When we pray, he's in our midst. I saw that with my own eyes that day. So then he prayed. As he was about to end his prayer, he said, Lord, please speak to me, Lord. When he said that sentence, I saw the Lord Jesus. Now the Lord was also standing by my side. At the same time, I was seeing a vision into the past. And in the past vision, the Lord was also standing by his side. And when he said, "Lord, please speak to me," the Lord opened his mouth to say something, and then he said the next sentence, "In Jesus' name I pray, Amen." You know, we laugh at this incident, but this is exactly what we do every day. Right? This is exactly what we do every day. And then the Lord turned and looked at me and he said, "Now do you understand what I meant when I said the problem is not with me, but the problem is with him?" Then the Lord said a statement that I have never forgotten for the rest of my life till today. "My children have no time to wait on me. They have no time to wait on me. They want me to behave like instant Maggie noodles." That's the exact word the Lord said. "They want me to behave like instant Maggie noodles. 2 minutes, everything is done." This is the reason why we are not progressing in our spiritual life. Forever, we always remain as turkeys instead of being eagles. You're not called to be a turkey, you know. If you're called to be a turkey, you'll end up on someone's dinner table on Thanksgiving Day. You're called to be eagle, soaring up like eagles in the high places in the heavenly realm. That's our call. That's the call of every minister. That's the call of every believer. That's the call of every church. You're seated together in the heavenly places, not down on earth. So why are we so weak, helpless, like what I just read to you, no? In distress, in debt, discontented, discouraged. Why? Because we are not planted in the Lord. You can be planted in a house of God, but are you planted in the Lord? Being a member of a church, running around all conferences, does not really feed you until you are planted in the Lord. Unless and until you are planted in the Lord, you will forever be discontented. You will forever be distressed. You will forever be discouraged. You will forever be unhappy. Something is missing. You know, there is a huge, mighty tree in the US called the sequoia tree. The sequoia tree grows up to 300 feet tall, and they're so big, so wide. So no matter what kind of storms come and blow on the tree, they may just sway a little bit, but they are rooted and strongly planted. No storms, no tornado, no hurricane can blow them apart. So some biologists, they wanted to discover what is the secret to the strength of this tree. So they dug under the roots of one particular tree and they discovered that the roots go miles deep into the earth and then they go sideways miles and are planted deeply in the soil and also connected to the root source or water source under that flows underneath the earth. Planted. This is the life that the God is calling us to be planted. We should be planted in a garden rather be a potted plant. You know what's the difference between a potted plant and a planted plant? A planted plant stays. A potted plant travels around. A potted plant can be removed from place to place, you know, for decoration. They are only for decoration, good for decoration. But a planted plant is in a fixed place, planted, and brings forth fruit. Potted plant doesn't bring forth fruit. It's only for decoration purpose. You know, in our office in India, we have many, many potted plants. So sometimes the housekeeper, they come and they change the position. One moment they are here, next moment they change over another place. So when I ask them, why have they done this? They say, oh, just to make the place look nice. So that it's not boring, always in the same position all the time. That's what a potted plant is. You go church hopping. Potted plants do that, you know. They go church hopping. Don't like this church, go to the next church. Don't like that church, go to the next church. But why we don't change our parents? Don't like this parent, change another. Don't like this mother, change another mother. We can't do that, right? Whether you like your mother or you don't like your mother, that is your mother. Likewise, where does God want you to be planted? Firstly, planted in the Lord. Are you planted in the Lord? You know, in the years to come, or from this year onwards, there's much, much storms that are going to blow upon the face of this earth. Much storms. Persecutions are going to come upon many nations. It has already started in India. With the new government that we have in India right now, from May of last year, now persecutions have slowly started to increase against the Christians. It's not done secretly, they are done openly. They are clamping down on the preaching of rights of the Christians. So what has started in one nation will sweep over to many, many nations. And unless and until you are planted in a good ground. Now that comes to the next point. Not just planted in the ground, you need to be planted in a good ground. We cannot just simply throw the seed on the street, by the wayside. You cannot throw the seeds on the stony ground. You cannot throw the seeds on thorny ground. You need to throw the seeds on the good ground. So you must know which is the good ground that you need to be planted. Not just any ground. All ground is ground, you know. But there's only one good ground. So you need to find which is the good ground that you need to be planted. So when you're planted in the good ground, then it will bring forth a lot of fruit. Sometimes a ground may not be good, but a good farmer can turn a bad ground into good ground.